Limited under our knowledge series initiative, which is called Project Share the Wisdom. This initiative was started by Dr. Ashok Ajmera itself, who is the chairman and the managing director of Ajcon Global, and he's also the moderator for the session this evening. So friends, as most of you all know, bad bank is not a new idea. It has been debated several times in the past and was of course a much awaited measure which has now been announced in the budget for 21-22. We are glad that bad bank is finally a reality and it is going to have a huge significance for the Indian banking sector. As we all know that the banking sector has been facing a large overhang of stress advances, and this would definitely help for us, for the banks to improve their capital adequacy ratios, help them to focus more on the core lending activities, and which in turn would provide better growth to the Indian economy. So the existing stock of bad loans, which is estimated at over 9 lakh crores, which is more than 8% of the loan book, is a big worry for banks. And this would be further elevated once the various relief measures that have been announced during the pandemic are waned off. The bad bank is proposed to have a dual structure, being an ARC and an AMC model, which will manage the NPAs in various ways. Some NPAs may be liquidated, others may be restructured. So we see continuous measures and a lot of proactiveness on RBI's front in this respect. And we've also seen that yesterday there was an announcement made by RBI to provide relief measures to small borrowers. So there have been many international success stories about bad bank, and we've seen many countries accomplishing their objectives. So there's no reason to believe why India cannot accomplish its objective as well. This evening, I'm joined by very esteemed and distinguished panelists, and it's a pleasure for me to have them on board. So it's Mr. Swaminathan Jankiraman from SBI, Mr. Pallav Mohapatra from ARCIL, and Mr. Gopalakrishna, who's the former ED of RBI. So thank you, sirs, for your time, and thank you for joining today's session. I would also like to quickly introduce all three of them. Mr. Swaminathan, he is a managing director of the Risk, Compliance and Stress Assets Resolution Group at State Bank of India. He has a career spanning of over 32 years with SBI and has held various assignments across finance, corporate and international banking, trade finance, retail, digital banking and branch management. He was the chief digital officer at SBI, and as a CGM, he managed more than 1150 branches. I can imagine, sir, what a task that was. In his present role, he oversees the risk management functions as well as the regulatory compliance framework, and also guides the stress assets vertical of SBI, which we all know is a huge portfolio. In fact, one of the largest NPA portfolio, being the leading bank of India. And as SBI's nominee, Mr. Swaminathan was a director on the boards of Yes Bank, NPCI, NPCI International, Jio Payments Bank. And he was also the SBI's nominee director and chairman on the board of SBI Payments Private Limited. He was the SBI's nominee on the board of Bank of Bhutan. So he's held various positions in the past. He's on the education front, he's done his executive MBA and he's a certified anti-money laundering specialist as well as a certified documentary credit specialist. So welcome, sir. We are really happy to be here. Coming to Mr. Pallav Mohapatra. Mr. Pallav Mohapatra is the Chief Executive Officer and the Managing Director of ARCIL, which is the Asset Reconstruction Company of India. ARCIL is among the top three ARCs based on the AUM of more than 1,200 crores and primarily operates in the corporate segment. Prior to this, Mr. Mohapatra was...
12,000 crores.
12,000 crores. I'm sorry for the mistake. Prior to this, Mr. Mohapatra was the MD and CEO of Central Bank of India. And before being elevated as the MD and CEO, he was the Deputy Managing Director, the DMD of the Stress Asset Management Group at SBI. Mr. Mohapatra has also been a member and on the governing board of various institutions and organizations. He was on the board of NIBF, IIBF, Institute of Banking Professional Management, Indian Institute of Bank Management, Guwahati. And so he's again, held several positions and contributed a lot to the industry. On the education front, he has an MSc in statistics and a certified associate of Indian Institute of Banking, CAIIB. a few other important assignments that he's handled during his stint at SBI. He's been the chief executive officer of SBI Cards. He's been the managing director of SBI Custodial Services, the vice president of the Forex department at SBI Los Angeles, and the chief general manager at the New Delhi Circle. So, thank you, sir, for joining us. We're really honored to have you. Coming to Mr. Gopalakrishna. Mr. Gopalakrishna is the former executive director of RBI, and he's held the position from October 2007 to April 2014. Where he was overseeing the Department of Banking Supervision, the Department of Non-Banking Supervision, the Department of Payment and Settlement System, Financial Stability Unit, the Department of Communication, the Department of Information Technology, and the Foreign Exchange Department. So again, various important departments that he's handled. He also headed the Deposit Insurance and Credit Guarantee Corporation, which is the DICGC. As he worked in various capacities in various departments of RBI, he's has that all around experience because he's been a regulator as well as a supervisor. And he was also appointed as the director for CAFRL, which is the Center of Advanced Financial Research and Learning, an organization promoted by RBI. So together, he has a working experience of more than 37 years with RBI and CAFRL put together. During his stint at RBI, he was appointed as the chairman of the working group on information security, electronic banking, technology risk management, and cyber frauds in 2010. And the recommendations made by this working group, and the report that they published also became an industry standard for banks and financial institutions. Contributes a very long way. Mr. Gopalakrishna also headed the group which created the RBS rating model, which was accepted and incorporated by the high-level committee on redesigning the supervisory architecture of RBI in 2012. In 2013, RBI appointed him as the chairman of the Inter-Regulatory Committee of FSDC, which recommended and created the legal entity identifier in India. He also led RBI's internal team, which created the large credit registry in 2014. As a director of CAFRL, his main responsibility included, creating research papers, doing capacity building for the senior management of banks and various other organizations. And he's currently the independent director on few companies. And he's also the director of RCPA, which is Risk and Compliance Professional Association. Which is a non-profit company providing a virtual classroom training on risk management and compliance. So, sir, again, sir, welcome aboard and thank you. We're really honored to have you. Now, I would like to hand over the further proceedings of the session to Dr. Ashok Ajmera, who is the curator of this event and also the moderator this evening. He is the chairman and managing director of Ajcon Group of Companies. We provide the entire gamut of financial services. And by profession, he's a qualified chartered accountant with more than 40 years of experience in corporate advisory services, investment banking, capital markets, and financial engineering. In the past, Dr. Ajmera has been very active on various committees of NSE, BSE, and the Brokers Association. He was an independent director on the board of Canara Bank Securities Limited and has served on the boards of BBF, Tito Incubation and Innovation Foundation, and many others. He's also been a very regular person on TV interviews. So he's given more than 2,000 interviews on capital markets. And, is this initiative of Project Share the Wisdom is a YouTube channel through which he has a vision of spreading knowledge. And we have more than 50 videos on various subjects covering finance and capital markets. So, please do feel free to go and see his videos. They're quite interesting and engaging. He's also one of the senior equity research analysts, which made a focus on public sector banks and the Indian economy. So great to have such a seasoned panel this evening. And we really look forward to hear your perspectives on the bad bank. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Pallavi. And Pallavi also, for all of you, information of all, is a chartered accountant, I think did it in 2000. She was in DSP Merrill Lynch for a few years, ICICI Bank. And thereafter, she has been heading the investment banking of Ashcon Group of Ashcon Global. In fact, she is spearheading that financial crime, you know, space. She is now going very fast in that space, educating people about the prevention of financial crime and detection of financial crime. In fact, we are the sole representative of ACFCS in India, Association of Certified Financial Crime Specialists, which Pallavi is heading that division. So with that, good evening to all of you and welcome to all the panelists and all our friends and associates, bankers, our guests who have joined this very important webinar today. I would like to recognize at least one person I see just in front of me on the screen, Shri Narendra Baldota Ji. Baldota Ji is a mining magnate, a very, very big industrialist. I think some of his mines also have the gold mines also. So welcome to you, sir. And he is the founder and the chairman and the owner of, Greater Mumbai Cooperative Bank. So welcome to you, sir. With that, friends, as Pallavi has already set the ball rolling, we have a great problem of NPA in India. And after this AQR and all these things started, the NPA identification, the increase in the amount of the non-performing assets, which has become a cause of great concern for all of us, including the regulators and, of course, all the stakeholders. So as she said, that almost about 9 lakh crores of the gross NPA. And for the public sector, I think it must be around 6,50,000 or 6,25,000 crores. And with SBI, of course, leading the pack, but at the same time, we should also see the business size of the SBI. I think, sir, we may be having about 60 lakh crores of business total, SBI. This is Swaminathan.
So, yeah, that is true. That's the total business size. Yeah. Yes.
So with that, gross NPA of 1,20,000 crore or so is not in that comparison. You know, it's just 5.5% as compared to many of the other banks. So with that, this bad bank concept, which was already there overseas in the international markets, was being talked about in India for last few years. But finally, with this year's budget speech of the Honorable Finance Minister, I think it has been given a proper shape now. And as per the expectation, the National Asset Reconstruction Company should have been formed by 31st March 2021. But I think maybe because of some procedural things, it has got delayed. So for that, I would come straight away to Mr. Swaminathan, sir, because I think you may be privy to most of the information, which we are not, about this origin of the bad bank in India, the formation, the structure going to be, the kind of capital structure, and the funding for this bank. So, sir, your views on that. We start with that formation and with that basic thought of the bad bank in India.
Yeah, good evening, everyone. Good evening, Ajmera ji and Pallavi. And also good evening to my esteemed co-panelists and to the audience. Of course, it's a great honor to cite Baldota ji. He is an icon running a bank. He may not remember now. 15 years ago, I used to be a credit officer for the account MSPL for the Hospit branch out of Bangalore. So, it is kind of a great privilege to be seeing him on the screen after very many years. He has hosted us in Hospit, and I'm sure it's good to see him there. I'm sure maybe Rahul and Shrenik would remember us. But it's a great privilege to be talking to through this forum, Ajmera ji. I would consider it as a proud privilege for me to be interacting with the panelists and with you. And of course, we are all waiting for the analyst meets to come back to its physical form for the SBI's results to start with first question always from Ajmera ji. That is something which we are missing for the last 1 year. I hope this pandemic goes away very soon. And till then, everyone should stay safe and take care. And I'm sure we will soon have those physical meetings where we will be glad to hear your question the first as we start our analyst meet. So thank you. That's for the opening part. Coming to the topic of the day, I would like to refer this for good order's sake as NARC, because the word bad bank was used for probably a couple of decades. We have been talking about this particular word, but then it never took birth. But we are very close to seeing that as reality, as the title says today. So I think for sake of good order, I would like to call it as NARC, the National Asset Reconstruction Company, as it is being envisaged now. The objective of this, I'm sure that all the participants are well aware, is essentially to provide a leading framework for debt resolution, which is, of course, today is handled in a diverse fashion amongst the banks. And ARCs, of course, is not a new concept to the country. They have been in place, but they also have certain limiting factors due to which the success has not been as much as we thought will happen to the ARC. Because ultimately, the bankers are the primary job of any banker is underwriting. And then a resolution and recovery is something which we do probably in 5 to 10% of the cases. But while we do underwriting in 100% of the cases, recovery resolution is in a small proportion. So the kind of bandwidth that we can allocate for resolution or recovery is very limited. The second aspect is, as bankers, because we deal in money, we look at more recovery as a mode rather than as a resolution, because resolution takes a longer time, also requires a higher bandwidth to handle. So keeping this in mind, specialized outfits like ARCs are considered something which can bring value, help in terms of resolution, also help in terms of maximizing the recovery. That is how this concept has come into play. And today, NARC is coming with two objectives I would like to highlight. Is one is that, as Pallavi rightly said, it is coming up in a structure of with a dual setup of an ARC and an AMC. Unlike the earlier ARCs that we have seen so far, that this is coming with, while of course the existing ARCs also can resort to that, but this is to start with itself, I have been sure it is coming with an ARC-AMC structure, where ARCs will play a lead role in terms of aggregating the debt, which is lying across the banks, and then AMC will take over in terms of every asset will be taken out as a separate kind of in common parlance that we can call it as an SPV kind of, where this AMC will form the trust to manage it, be an O&M agency, maximize the recovery for all the stakeholders. So that is one concept this NARC and AMC structure is standing out from the rest of the ARCs as we see. The second and the most important aspect is, as the ARCs have been going on their own, soliciting, taking out the debt from various financial institutions, they have not been able to achieve the aggregation that is required for a smoother resolution. You may acquire maybe 20%, 30%, 40%, but unless you have a majority stake or the best is having the entire 100%, the ARCs are limited in terms of finding a resolution and better recovery. So this NARC, because it is being mandated and then coming with the backup of the government, it is likely to be a smoother affair in terms of all the banks deciding together to transfer the entire asset, which means that the aggregation is going to be near 100% and there is going to be an AMC structure. So together, we expect that this will be a winning formula. I think I will stop here, and maybe if there are any follow-on questions, I can respond to that.
You're on mute, sir.
Sorry, I was mute. Sir, if you take it a little further, can you explain a little more in detail about how these transactions will take place, whether it is the same way what is being done today, that the bidding and that process or it will be for all the banks. What I understand is that it will be for public sector banks also, as well as the private sector, any bank or financial institution can come in, you know, to pitch for the bad assets of the bank. So, but how this whole modality will take place? How will it be different than the existing system?
Absolutely, as you rightly said, for this model to succeed, it cannot just be hosting only for public sector banks. While of course it is expected, because 70% of the banking system and an equal percentage of NPAs lying with public sector banks, yes, they will take a lead role in this. But as we understand at this point in time, NARC will be all encompassing. It will take into account public sector bank, private sector bank, for that matter, any financial institution which has an exposure to the identified account. So that is number one. Number two, the model is of transfer. See, essentially what we'll have to, I think you use the right word. One is that the sale to ARC is where we need to worry about the pricing part of it very, very deeply, because there is an outright sale that is happening. But however, in the structure, as we understand, as we speak, of course, you also mentioned that I may be privy to a few things. I just would like to clarify for, again, good order's sake, that I know as much as it is in the public domain. It is not that, you know, we have something more than what is in public domain, because in this country, there is hardly anything which is a secret. So everything what is being discussed, whichever is the forum that all of us are, there is no information asymmetry. That much at least I can assure you. So as we understand at this point in time, the banks together, led by, of course, the lead lender or the nominated lender in case of a multiple banking arrangement, will take a decision in the consortium or the joint lenders forum and take a decision to transfer this to NARC for better management of the asset. As of now, what we know is that this may start off with a cutoff of banking exposures of 500 crores and above. So that is a kind of a cutoff that we are looking at, while what is remaining below 500 will continue to be under the old mechanism. Exposures, banking exposures in excess of 500 crores and above will be identified. The lead lender will facilitate the discussion in a joint lender forum, take the majority approval, and then facilitate a transfer. The third aspect is at what rate the transfer can take place. As we understand at this point in time, for each of the identified assets, NARC will make an offer basis which whatever is their judgment in terms of the realizable value, they make an offer. So now this offer is what will be discussed in the joint lenders forum. If that offer is found to be good enough, then the banks take a decision to transfer, or they may enter into a discussion with NARC for improvement of that offer. After NARC makes a firm offer, it is open to a Swiss challenge. Now, this offer is put out in the open by the lead lender. Anyone, any ARC or any other party who is interested in picking this up, if they would like to provide a counter offer, and in that, in the case that it is better than NARC, the lead lender will be free to transfer this asset to that party who has made a better offer. Of course, NARC being the principal or the anchor will have an option to challenge that or match that bid. If they match or better it, then it can go to NARC. Because the point that I'm trying to make is that there will be a price discovery process, although it may not be as elaborate as what we see in terms of open e-auction. But NARC make the lead lender taking a decision to transfer basis the majority decision, the JLF, an offer being made by NARC, that offer being open to a Swiss challenge, and then the asset going to NARC if NARC offer is considered the better one among the Swiss challenge method. That is how the arrangement is being envisaged, because one key component that we have to understand is we need to establish true sale in its spirit, letter and spirit. Otherwise, we can't take it out from our books. So that is the reason that this Swiss challenge method is something which is under discussion at this point in time. But as we speak, a lot of discussion also is happening in terms of what form and shape this should take. So these are kind of details still in the working, but this is what is the information that we are hearing at this point in time.
So sir, when you said that the majority decision in the JLM, so is that clear that majority, say if it is say 500 crore and 250 crore worth of lenders, I mean in their books, if they say that, okay, let us go for NARC, It will go, or it is on some specific basis will come beyond this majority?
Yeah, these are again, as I said, still in the works. Whether it is to be 51%, 66%, 76%, these are not something which has been determined, at least to the best of my knowledge. But I think it will more or less the majority in terms of number, majority in terms of value, I think has more or less fairly stabilized in the IBC. So whatever is the kind of majority determined in terms of value and number in an IBC process is what I think would be, because some of these accounts will be already under IBC process, as you would know.
Yes.
Because 500 crore and above, and it is an NPA, they may be already under IBC process. There may be a COC, there may be a JLF working on it. So I would imagine at this point in time, majority in terms of number of lenders, majority in terms of value may more or less be aligned with the IBC process. But then the caveat is that it is not something which is as it is written now. It will get firmed up over the next few weeks is what I expect.
Thank you, sir. I'll come back again to you. So, sir, Mr.
Thank you.
Sir, now you are already now heading the, as Pallavi said, the third largest or maybe second or fourth, whatever is there, ARC already there. For last so many years, this ARC is there are still. How do you react on this proposal of Fed Bank or NARC? And where do you find yourself now? I mean, whether you will be competing with them or with that bank, or you would be having sufficient business apart from that 500 crore plus. So what is your first reaction on this and your views on this, sir?
Thank you, Dr. Ajmera. And let me thank to you, your organization, and also Pallavi for giving me this opportunity. And as our association, I think Dr. Ajmera goes, as Mr. Swaminathan said, that you used to be there always in the NLS meet. So I know you from those days. And then when I moved to Central Bank of India, we used to have very frequent interactions, and I learned a lot from you also. So I welcome my fellow panelists also, and I also welcome the audience who are taking part in this particular webinar. I have some basic questions, because it is not that I was not in the banking fraternity. I was there, and I moved to ARC only in the recent past. And when this idea of this NARC was being mooted, so I was in the bank. So I was also a part of some discussions in IBA when it was announced by the Honorable Finance Minister, and then the job was assigned, or the task was assigned to IBA to work on this. Just I want to basically comment on this NARC instead of bad bank, what Mr. Swaminathan said. I still remember when I was DMD in Stress Asset Resolution Group in SBI. At that time, including the advances under collection account, I was managing a portfolio of more than 3 lakh crore. And that, in some sense, that was, I think, larger than some of the public sector banks' total business portfolio. So there was a discussion, because this bad bank announcement was also made in earlier budget when our honorable late Sri Jaitley Saab was the finance minister. So at that time, I still remember Mr. B. Sriram, because everyone used to say that Pallav is heading a bad bank. So Mr. Sriram was my MD. So he used to intervene. He said that, see, Pallav is not heading a bad bank. He is heading a good bank, because whatever result he gives, that is going to go a great, a long way in the profitability of the bank. So this is on the bad bank and the good bank. Now on this, before going to the opportunities which will be available to the ARC, I just want to have some sort of clarification, not clarification, because Mr. Swaminathan has already given the disclaimer that he is only privy to the information, whatever is available on the public domain. So But the question here is that when we are talking about the price discovery through the Swiss challenge, now the Swiss challenge as such is already there, right? Now, if suppose this Swiss challenge is done in case of after this NARC is established, then if some ARC, hypothetically, they bid more than what is the binding offer given by NARC, right? And NARC feels that it is not commercially viable or commercially prudent to match that bid, then that basically assignment will go to the ARC who has bid higher. Now, if that happens, then what will happen to the structure of 1585 and 85% being the SR? Then how the banks today, if suppose the banks are going to get the sovereign guarantee on the SR, then as per the RBI regulation as of today, if the cash component is less than 90%, then they have to make the provision in the books, in the investment book, just like they were doing in the loan book. Now, if suppose ARC other than NARC, they get this asset, then what will happen to that SR and what will happen to the provisioning requirement on those SRs? Okay, the answer can be that since the provision coverage ratio is 85% and more, so the impact will not be that much. Okay, that may be an answer, but I'm just raising this question.
Yes.
That because the government of India is not going to give the sovereign guarantee if any other ARC basically gets the assignment. That is for sure. I think Mr. Swaminathan will also agree to it. Now, the second part where I'm confused a little bit is that why there is a dual structure of ARC and AMC. If you look at the global scenario, there is nothing called ARC. It is AMC only. The AMC acquires, the AMC manages, the AMC resolves. But here, there is two-tier structure of ARC and then AMC. Now, what happens is whenever asset is acquired, that asset is to be acquired through a trust. The trust can have a portfolio of assets or can have a single asset. Now, if suppose this trust is to be open in AMC, then what would be open in NARC? So these are certain process parts which as of now, I'm not very clear about. But on the opportunity, sir, as again, I read from the newspaper that one or two banks, they have said that they will not sell the asset to NARC if they have some exposure in even more than 500 crore exposure. The other ARCs have got the opportunity, number one. Number two is there is still a huge opportunity or potential for less than 500 crore, and especially in the retail and SME. Now, what I feel is that in case of a large chunk NPA in the corporate book, most of these are on the verge of resolution or have been fully provided for or have been written off. Now, new cases which are coming in this corporate sector are not that much. With this second wave, the surge which will be seen in retail and MSME. So the ARCs today have a lot of opportunities for buying the portfolio of retail and MSME. And the second part is, don't forget it is only the banks. NBFCs can also sell assets to ARC. Now, NBFC may be part of NARC. I don't know the what will be the structure, but the ARCs are now gradually moving towards acquiring the assets from the NBFCs. And most of these assets which are acquired from the NBFCs are on bilateral terms. That is which is as per regulation. That means the ARC gets a bid to the NBFC. and that NBFC, if it is okay with that, or after negotiation, they basically sell it to the banks. And most of the assets which have been sold by NBFC to ARC are on 1585 structure. So that is also not impacting the capital of the ARC, because only 15% is being invested by the ARC. Number two, the ARC like us, which are sponsored by the lead lender of the country, State Bank of India, and also the fund like Avenue Capital. So Avenue Capital, other than being a sponsor, they are into this particular field of stress asset funding in a big way. And in USA and in some parts of Europe, they are playing a major role. Now, what they do, in addition to whatever capital they have invested, they also invest in the trust. Like, for example, I do a 100% cash sale purchase with the SBI. SBI is getting its own total amount, maybe whatever is the acquisition price. I put 15%, I means ARC, and 85% is being put by the Avenue Capital or some other investor. So in this way, the capital management by the ARC to a great extent is being addressed to. So I don't think there would be any dearth of opportunities. I'm not being alerted or alarmed by that this NARC comes up to what will happen to our business. I still feel that there is the cake is large enough for everyone to have a take. I will end here, and I will respond to any follow-up
questions. Your views are well taken, sir. And in a very short time, you have explained, so that the ARCs, the existing ARCs need not worry with this NARC coming in. With this, I'll come to Mr. Gopalakrishna. Sir, you have worked for a long time, in the space of regulating or controlling, and even, the ARCs, the entire, roadmap which has happened, for the ARCs in India, the total evolvement of the ARCs. So can you give some perspective on the existing ARCs and ARC structure in India, and what kind of business they are doing it, so that it will strengthen the point of Mr. Mohapatra that yes, they are doing good business and there is no problem, no dearth of business for them. So sir, over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Rajmira Saab and Pallavi ji for inviting me. Of course, since I retired in 2017, I had no opportunity to interact with these two great leaders today. Of course, I've heard about them in various forums. So I'm very happy that they're in this panel. In fact, in my case, I was also a supervisor, a regulator, as also now I am on a board of one of the ARC for the last 4 years. So I can give the perspective of both the regulator as well as the regulated entity. I request Pallavi ji to please put out some of the slides which will be useful for our discussion. In fact, this is the most useful slide, I feel. As you all of us are aware, the SARFAESI Act of 2002 brought into the focus the creation of asset reconstruction companies in India. The asset reconstruction companies in India are very unique. In fact, implementing this, I understand the teams have visited various countries, and finally they sought and they decided to have our own type of asset reconstruction companies. And that is how the creation of the ARC happened in India. And this figure is very important. 2003 and 4, only two ARCs were there, starting from RCL and one more. And the recovery was only 8.9%. And over a period, look at these figures. The recovery was on account of by the ARCs of the assets purchased from the banking system. Recovery used to be 61%, 33%, 30%. Only in 2014 and 15, with the change of government, change of systems, things changed. And it became only in 2017, 18 again, where there was a lump sum recovery of 32%. In fact, to give you the perspective of the figures, 2019-20, as on March 31st, there was 1,96,744 crore NPAs with the ARCs, and the recovery was 40,074 crores. So it is not a small amount in terms of course, now it is overshadowed by the IBC. So IBC recovery is now 45% almost. Otherwise, the among all other mechanism to recover NPAs, ARC was more effective till recently. Only in the last few years, we know the reasons, and we will discuss that a little later, why it happened. Kindly change to the next slide. Yeah, this is a figure. In fact, this is based on the RBI publication. For the first time, RBI has published in the bulletin of April 2021 and a very good analysis of the ARCs since inception using the supervisory data. Normally, this data is not available in the public domain, but the first time RBI has shared all the details. That is how I could get this data. In fact, today you have almost 28 ARCs. Till 2007 and 8, there was not much. 2007-8, there was a huge growth. Again, 2015 and 16, you have a large number of ARCs coming into existence, including many of them sponsored by FIIs. And today you have some FIIs which are sponsored by the FIIs, and they are also competing with the existing bank. When it comes to the assets under management, which is after discounting, that is after winning the bids or whatever methods, whether bilateral or by way of Swiss action auction, there is to be a very, very dull period. Only in 2013-14, there was a spike. After that, again, it has come back. So in terms of acquisition of assets by the ARCs from the banking system, now it is on the lower side, especially after 2014-15. You will see the trajectory. It is coming down, down, down. Similarly, the ARCs and as a percentage of gross NPAs of the banks also is coming down. So that shows that ARCs have a problem as far as they are concerned. There is a problem which we will discuss in the question answer session. Some of the issues will come out during our interaction. So what is the reason why they are not growing now? Most of the bankers know the reason, and let us see why we have to do something more to enable ARCs to be more effective. So next is the concentration of ARCs. The next slide, Pallaviji, kindly change to the next slide. Yeah. The entire ARC market domain is dominated by four or five ARCs. Although we have 28 ARCs, only five are very, very prominent. And you look at the AUM of the five top ARCs, it is 40% of the assets under management is managed by them, and only the 60% is managed by the rest of, say, 20, 23 ARCs. So many of them are very, very minuscule. Some of them are defunct. They have not surrendered the license, but the activities are very, very small. So only, if I am correct, only the top 10 are really active. And now these new ARCs, which have come into existence after 2016, they have become a little active. Otherwise, the market is very, very dull. Same with in terms of the contribution of the capital, the slide is slightly obligated. So banks continue to be the major source of capital. And they are also major source of borrowings. ARCs, you know, as you are aware, initially they started with 2 crore, and later on RBI increased over a period, and now 100 crore is the minimum capital to be invested. And of course, they also have to meet the 15% CRAR. And today most of the ARCs depend on banks and financial institutions for their capital. Capital is a big constraint, and that's how the growth has come down drastically in the last few months, except for the group companies like Edelweiss or those who have a group backing, they are able to raise capital. Otherwise, the ARCs which have come on the back of the FIIs, they have a huge capital. But the remaining in between ARCs, practically they don't have capital today, and they are constrained. Yeah, kindly move to the next slide. Yeah, this is a major distribution of the liabilities of the ARCs. As you are seeing here, net-owned funds used to be the highest. Today, net-owned funds is hardly 35% of the system. And other liabilities have gone up. And similarly, borrowings have come down. Borrowings have come down because most of the banks and most of the ARCs are trying to switch over to other liabilities like NCDs, like bonds. Since some of them have a better rating, they are not able to now able to raise funds by issuing bonds. And in fact, the entire World Bank, most of the bad banks are funded by the bond market. But in India, we still have a constraint. Let us see how this NARC is going to evolve in the next few months or years. Next slide, please. Yeah, this is the distribution of borrowings. Some more breakup I'm trying to give. So today, intercorporate deposit loans and bonds and debentures, these two have become more, because they are not able to raise capital. Now more capital is being raised, more resources is being raised by to intercorporate and by bonds and debentures, especially those ARCs which have a group backing. Those ARCs who are standalone, they are suffering because they are not able to even borrow in the system. Although they have opportunities in the so much NPAs are lying, they are not able to compete because they don't have capital. Yeah, next slide, please. Yeah, so this is another important slide I thought I should share out of the analysis published by Reserve Bank of India. Here also you'll see that only 6 ARCs are dominant. I think this is the Edelweiss, if I'm correct. They are the number one for last several years. And others are slightly reduced. ARCL used to be one of my major ARC, but over a period, they also have reduced their share in the market. And as I said, only 5-6 ARCs dominate the entire banking system, the ARC system. This is once again very important in terms of the aging of the SRs. As you are aware, the ARCs issue, earlier they used to issue, give 5% cash and rest in the SRs. In 2014-15, RBI mandated banks that minimum there should be 15% cash and 85% SRs. So the original guidelines of RBI was that within 5 years, the ARCs should realize and close the SRs or honor the SRs. But somewhere in 2014, once again, because of the pressure from the system, RBI has now permitted 5+3. So up to 8 years, the SRs can be in the system. Beyond 8 years, it is a loss both to the banks which are holding SR as well as the ARCs which are holding the 15%. They have to write off. And you'll see here also, the SRs which are maturing in 7 years is quite high. That is in the current year, 2000, this column is missing, 2001, 21, and 2022, almost 16,000 crore has to be realized by the ARCs in the current year. There is a lot of pressure on them, on their performance. And next slide, please. Yeah, this is the once again, who is holding the SRs? As you're seeing, most of the SRs are held by selling banks. although RBI SEBI has been promoting that SR should be traded in the secondary market so that these have a very ARCs can raise further funds and reinvest in some other new assets. But actually, it is not happening because most of the SRs are only in the last 2 years because of the mandate by RBI. No SRs are being issued. After 19, entire transactions are happening on cash basis. So because of that, the SRs held by banks is coming down. But original intention of RBI and SEBI was that these SRs should be traded and bank the ARCs can sell it or trade in secondary market, come back to the primary market and invest in assets. That is not happening. So I am not discussing the profitability of the ARCs. ARCs, despite all these things, many of them are doing well. So in terms of profitability, they are making good money. Only the return on capital, return on equity is slightly low compared to other markets.
Okay.
So to some, there are several issues which I thought during the question answer session or after the other speakers complete.
Sir, thank you very much for such an elaborate presentation with all the statistics which are actually generally not known to the people in so much in detail. But yes, it will be very good to because
so it was available in available in the RBI bulletin. So please go through it, whoever is interested. Yeah.
Yes, sir. It's good to know because we are talking about the bad bank and new big ARC coming in. So what is happening to existing ARCs? And so that we can also understand what was the flaw, the way initially the high capital, high this thing, but then it went down, the capital proportion came down and the more of the borrowing and bonds and other things have increased, which one has to take care. I mean, you should have your money. So on that, sir, Swaminathan, sir, again, coming back to our bad bank, how the bad bank will be funded? I mean, basically by the same public sector banks and some of the other players. And what kind of fund base, the capital base, and the which the government is planning for it? I mean, it has to be a little substantial.
Yeah, that's a very good question. See, at this point in time, it's very clear that it's a collaborative effort of the banks and financial institutions. So it is expected that, of course, for an ARC, there has got to be a sponsor and also participating investors. So it is envisaged at this point in time as a collaborative effort where public sector banks, private sector banks, and maybe some NBFCs, at least some larger ones probably, can come together. While, of course, one will have to take the anchor investment as a sponsor for the RBI approval because ARCs, as you know, come under the SARFAESI structure and then requires RBI approval. So it is expected that there will be one of the lending institutions will be the anchor and rest of them will pitch in as financial investor. Because anything in excess of 10% becomes a sponsor, below which is normally considered as a financial investment. So others will be financial investment. And the second thing, as we know at this point in time, that efforts are on currently to ascertain the interest of the various lending institutions. And once that gets firmed up, the shareholding pattern, etc., will get determined. And also who amongst them will take the lead to be the sponsor also will be determined. I think it's again in a matter of details and then maybe probably over the next few weeks, we must hear on that front very clearly. Coming to the third part of your question in terms of what is the funding required? See, we know again that it is going to be a 15-85 structure, 15% upfront in cash and then 85% in SRs. That is likely to come with a government guarantee in terms of realization amount. So 15% cash, so which means that the NARC will have to have capital at least to the extent of 15% so that they can upfront pay the lending institutions the cash that needs to be paid. So the capital requirement will be a derivative of the accounts that will get transferred. So again, if you apply the 500 crore cutoff, and as rightly mentioned by Mr. Mahapatra also, that accounts, there are a few accounts which will get excluded. A few accounts may not get the mandate from all the banks. A few accounts may be very close to resolution, maybe in 2-3 months kind of. So there's no point in transferring it. Lending institutions may want to hold on. So the number is still not frozen as to what number will move. Just to take a hypothetical case, assuming that 1 lakh crore worth of assets move. I'm just giving a very arbitrary number, because at this point in time, unless we have a consensus amongst all the lenders as to which accounts will go, at this moment, we have only a cutoff now at this point in time. I'm just assuming about 1 lakh will go. And then NARC will have to make an offer. So what has been the normal realization percentage of most of this? We saw those in the slides. What has been the ARC recovery percentage? What has been the SARFAESI recovery percentage? What has been the IBC recovery percentage? Of course, IBC recovery percentage looks very attractive at this point in time, because we had some marquee names that got resolved in the first 2 years. So that has to be, if you take out that, the large 2-3 resolutions that took place, the resolution, the recovery has been in the range of 20-25%. If you do an aggregated manner in which you look at it, of SARFAESI, of that is DRT, I mean, when I said SARFAESI, I meant DRT, the IBC.
How did you say 30%?
20-25% has been a kind of an average. That's, I think,
so suppose on that 1 lakh crore, say about 20,000 crore.
Yeah, 20-25,000 crores. Okay. Can be considered as a reasonable realizable value based on the past average. Because in one or two accounts, it may be 40%. In one or two accounts, it could have been even 10%. Some accounts would have gone into even liquidation. So, on an average, if you take about, say, 20%. So, 1 lakh crore, maybe NARC may be wanting to acquire this, say, at that 20%, which banks also may be comfortable transferring, because that is what their average. So, on 20,000 crores, the NARC will have to pay 15% cash.
3,000 crores.
So obviously, it will be about 3,000 crores to start with. Assuming that the transfer of assets is about 1 lakh crore. If that becomes 150, it moves up proportionately. If it becomes only 50,000, it moves down proportionately. So the requirement is not going to be very huge. If a clutch of 10-12 banks are going to come up together, and that too with maybe a couple of leading NBFCs which have exposure to large accounts, if they can come in, I think each of them will be required to put in not a big sum at this point in time. So it is not a challenge to pull together that money, since this is being seen as a collaborative exercise and very, very strongly backed by the government. So at this point in time, there is a huge support that is coming from all over the place. So I think funding this is not going to be a major challenge. That is what is my view.
Some working of the numbers, like we are almost at the very advanced stage of this formation of this bank. So especially looking at the SBI, like you are the biggest stakeholder either way. I mean, either you look it from the bad asset transfer point of view or raising the bank point of view, you must have done some calculation at your own end with this 500 crore plus or this thing. So some understanding of number of accounts or the kind of amount which is getting involved into it, at least from SBI point of view, sir?
You're very right. The exercise is on. We have a small group which is working on this. But then, see, one is the cutoff. 500 crores and above, I have X number of accounts. So now a judgmental call has to be taken in terms of how many accounts can be transferred. But see, ultimately, why would a bank transfer if only there is going to be a value maximization? If there is something which I can do myself, which will give me certain value. And if this NARC comes as an alternate option, if there is going to be a better realization, or that my bandwidth gets released so that I can do something else, only the transfer can take place, number one. Number two, as you know, 500 crores and above exposure is all consortium or multiple banking. So we need to do a consensus building. Maybe in many accounts, SBI can be a lead bank, maybe in 60% of the accounts, but in 40% of the accounts, by a rule of thumb, I'm saying, in about 60% of the account, SBI can be a lead bank. about 40% can be, other banks can be a lead bank. So these discussions are currently on. And once the NARC details are completely penciled in and then gets notified by the government, I am sure these things will get firmed up. Otherwise, all of us can talk in terms of numbers only in a hypothetical manner. That's why I gave you that 1 lakh crore and then gave you a calculation. Otherwise, even within SBI, we know what are the accounts in excess of 500 crores, in how many accounts we are lead bank, in how many accounts we can probably transfer, in a few accounts why we need not transfer. These are kind of discussions happening. But disclosing any number at this point in time will be premature because NARC in itself is not a legal entity at this point in time. So the framework is still in the works. So I think maybe give us about maybe 4 to 6 weeks time. I think we will have a lot more clarity on this.
I appreciate, sir, on this. Sir, dwelling little more on that, because we are having a discussion, you know, ultimately for the knowledge of the people and the to take back home something. On the this pricing front, you know, like we were discussing, Mr. Mohapatra was also saying. So now NARC will have the government guarantee for the remaining 85%. Now government guarantee is a government guarantee. Maybe, okay, 1-2 year here and there. Maybe they may say 5 years, 7 years, or now this is 8 year realization or whatever it is. But ultimately you will get your money. And I understand that from that SR, which is government guaranteed, you can further raise money. I don't know. I mean, whether I'm right on that. So based on that, suppose there is an offer for, say, yes, Mr. Mohapatra was also saying, say, offer of about, say, 100 crore for an asset of, for a book of 500 crore or, say, 700 crore and from NARC. And then some other ARC comes and says, okay, I'll give you 150 crore down, but the balance will be my SR. I'm a big ARC. I mean, you believe me on my net worth, I got a very good foreign partner. So those kind of negotiations also will take place. The bank will give consideration to that or blindly just say that, no, we are 100% guaranteed. So we are not looking at any other option.
No, you are very right. These are kind of things as we go forward only can get ironed out. At this point in time, not that we have an answer for all these questions that could come up, as Mr. Mohapatra also highlighted. See, if you look at it, 15% cash and 85% SRs guaranteed by the government of India. Now, someone comes and says, I will give you 25% cash and 75% SRs, but then government guarantee is missing. So now, how do you compare these two? Because we are used to doing a net present value of any offer. And then we have a matrix at this point in time, even as part of IBC process, we have a matrix. People come up with multiple instruments, not just cash. Cash is a small component, but there are multiple instruments that come up. So we do a net present value. There is a transparent mechanism by which the lenders, the COC, establishes, yes, this particular offer is H1, this offer is H2 kind of. Because we are comparing similarly placed instruments. In this case, there is going to be some amount of asymmetry in the sense that the SRs of NARC is going to be government guaranteed, which is something will be absent in the hands of any other ARC, which comes as a challenge. So now, how do I put a value to the government guarantee is something which needs to evolve. It has not yet evolved. But one thing, very quick take, we can say government guarantee is like cash, where it's a sovereign guarantee. So I will say if somebody has to challenge, then that ARC has to come all cash. So you come all cash, fine. I don't need to wait for 3 years or 5 years. Cash is better. So I can sell that to you. But then this is something which I'm just giving a very off-the-cuff response to it. But at this point in time, the comparison or evaluation matrix has not yet evolved. One formidable challenge will be to compare the absence of government guarantee. How do we put a value to it when we compare the competing offers? This is going to be one major challenge. But then I think we are in a collaborative structure. I don't see this as a challenge, but we have seen that as RPC evolved. We are seeing that as IBC is evolving. These challenges get thrown at us, but I think the combined wisdom of all of us, we will find a way to make a transparent comparison and then establish who is H1. And ultimately, it will go to H1. That is not going to change. If NARC is H1, they get it. If they are not, they are not going to. But how that H1 will be established will be by way of a matrix, which should be acceptable and transparent and sincere to all the participants. I think that is how it will evolve. maybe that will take a few months to get evolved is what is my sense at this point.
So we will have another seminar maybe after 3 months on this when we have more clarity. In the meantime, okay, now we switch over to both Mr. Gopalakrishnan and Mr. Mohapatra. Some international perspective can you give if you have some practical, actual on this ARC or the kind of, what kind of, but yes. We have a little shortage of time. So in just 4 or 5 minutes, we can cover
One second, sir. I think let Mr. Gopalakrishnan give the perspective on the international structure. Yes, I will like to comment upon on what Mr. Swaminathan has said about the government guaranteed SRs. As of today, again, I'm saying, Mr. Swaminathan, I'm not challenging anyone. Again, with the knowledge of banking knowledge, and now whatever knowledge I have gained in ARC, because before coming to ARC, I didn't know so many technical things in the ARC, which is as per the regulation. Now, as per the regulation, as Mr. Gopalakrishnan has rightly said, that the trust life can be 5 years, can be extended up to 8 years, right? And after 8 years, the trust has to be closed. Or even if with the consent of the SR holders, the trust is left open, but the value of the SRs will be written off. Right. Now, I know whenever there is a sovereign guarantee, even to the loans, the account cannot be downgraded to NPA as long as there is a sovereign guarantee. But what about the provision? If suppose the SR which has been given by the government, now the asset has not, the nature of asset has not undergone a change. If the ARC have not been able to resolve it, maybe some efficiency factor is there. Maybe in case of NARC, since the debt aggregation will be better than what ARCs are doing now, so there will be better efficiency in the resolution. But the question remains, the nature of asset or the nature of this toxic asset will not undergo a major change with the with the birth of NARC. Now, after 8 years, even if there is a sovereign guarantee, what will happen to that trust? Will the trust be there with the value of SR as such because there is a sovereign guarantee? Then there has to be change in the regulation. RBI has to change the regulation that only in case of NARC, the trust where the SR has been guaranteed by the sovereign, that will remain. So these are the questions which will need not only the structure to be created, but lot of changes in my opinion, as per my knowledge, from the regulation point of view. Regulation has to undergo a major change, as you rightly said about true sale. Now, if there is a Swiss challenge, if there is a Swiss challenge. Now, in case of ARC, the SR is not guaranteed. In case of NARC, it is guaranteed. So there has to be a, I will say, a special statute for this. Otherwise, this would be treated as a discrimination, right? So I think I am totally ignorant about it as compared to you, Mr. Swaminathan. But there are many questions which, as per me, still remain unanswered. And I also believe that with the passage of time, definitely all the questions will be answered. And the structure will come with, even after creation of the structure, lot of issues will come out, which will be ironed out. So this is the limited point I wanted to highlight.
You are absolutely right, sir. I have a question. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
No, with due permission from Mr. Gopalakrishnan also. I think I just wanted to respond to Balavji. Balavji, you are a legend in the stress assets resolution vertical. I have been a student of you and I will continue to be a student. I don't think I'm going to be privy to more things than what you would know. That is number one. Number two, as you rightly said, some regulatory changes will be definitely necessary when we are attempting a never before seen initiative of this nature. And I'm sure all of you are aware that the Reserve Bank has already set up a panel to review the ARC functioning, and then a very eminent people have been put in the committee.
Yes,
there's a 6-member committee that has been formed. So I'm sure that this NARC announcement also will be part of the discussion this committee will have. And I'm sure they will ensure that, as you rightly said, how the existing ARCs are not put in a disadvantage vis-a-vis this. I'm sure will also be a part of that discussion. I'm sure that this regulation relating to ARC, I think Mr. Gopal Krishna has been part of both regulation and supervision. I'm sure he'll be able to throw more light on this. But I think these changes are bound to happen. And a widespread industry-wide consultation is on already, and all the stakeholders are participating. A committee of very eminent people have been put in place. I'm sure that they will come up with some comprehensive recommendation. Yes, so sir. I'm sure that maybe, as I said, for a few questions, we don't have an answer today. But I think all these concerns will get together, debated, and maybe in over the next few weeks, the regulator, I'm sure, will come up with certain guidelines which will make these things a reality and make our life better. That's my expectation. Thank you. Thank you for the extra time for me. Thank you.
No, not at all, sir. One of the committee members is, again, your former DMD of SBI. So, SBI is everywhere. Yes, sir. And in fact, I got a question on the chat. Somebody wrote to me that whether it should remain under RBI or a separate statute should be prepared for this NARC. Somebody has just a wild thought that why don't a separate enactment for this, so that they will not be required to circumvent any of the existing provisions, but a fresh provisions can be made and a statute can be. But I don't know how far it is possible. Oh, I think it will remain under RBI only with the existing. Yes, yes, Mr. Gopal Krishna. In short, sir, some perspective on the international.
You see, bad bank or the asset management company is very, very prevalent abroad. Only in India, it is not there. Most of these resolution agencies, like FDIC in USA and so many, they already have a bad bank. That is, out of their respective legislation, they can create. It is said that in USA, a bad bank is closed on a Friday, restructured. And Monday, a new bank is allowed to come into existence and depositors are allowed to transact. So that is there in the UK. In the USA, it is more than 100 years old. But I'm not talking because we do not have a FDRI bill so far. So we cannot talk about bad bank. So what I'm quoting, once again, from a research study, it is a European model, which is also an asset management company, which is also a bad bank. In fact, the research report is available in the BIS. Last year, they had published a study. Post 2011 or 2008 global financial crisis, Europe had large number of banks which are having huge NPAs. Some of them had 25-30% NPAs, particularly big countries, Portugal, Ireland, and all these countries. So what they did was they studied some 135 countries, 135 banks in the European Union. And based on that, there is some analysis which is very relevant to Indian context.
Okay.
One is the research finding is that the bad bank segregations are effective for cleaning the balance sheet of the and promoting bank lending only if they combine recapitalization with segregation. So what we are doing is good.
Yes.
The only advantage in our case is since the SRs are going to be guaranteed by government, the capital requirement will not be there to a greater extent. That is my presumption. So this is one of the most important aspects of all this European model, where a bad bank has been a very, very successful story. And then used in isolation, neither tool will suffice to spur lending and reduce future NPAs. If you want to really revive lending and reduce NPA, you have to use both models, reducing NPAs plus recapitalizing. And finally, there are very interesting analyses. When funding to purchasing impaired assets from the original bank is private, bank lending grows more and future NPAs declined more when funding comes from public source. In Europe also, they tried both private okay, funding yeah. as well as funding by other agencies like deposit insurance and so many others. And they found that wherever private funding is there, it was efficient because there was market forces working together, and that is why there was more recovery. Wherever government funding was there, the recovery was less. That is what the analysis says. The originating bank that transfers small fraction of their assets to the bad bank exhibits stronger loan growth and lower future NPLs than do banks that transfer large chunk. So this is also a good lesson for us. And finally, in countries where legal system is very more efficient, credit recovery and NPA reduction are stronger in response to the impaired credit in the system. So these are the three analyses which has thrown out of this European model. And Europe today, all these banks in PIC countries are having high capital. Despite 8 or 9 years ago, they were almost a bad bank, but today many of them are efficient banks. They have a high capital because of the these actions they have taken.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. But in India, in India, the problem is of the capital only. You know, ochi capital dhani ko khaye. You know, like in every business, like government will put a target. Okay, come on, we will not give guarantee for more than 5,000.
Even private sector,
they might put a cap there also. We never know.
I was told private sector can participate in this model, and that is what I understand. Okay. Even in India, private sector can participate.
Yeah, correct. So before we take the questions of the audience, just one point, you know, which is very, very important in today's context. The second wave of COVID, sir. Swaminathan, sir, like your views on this now, once again, you know, we are going through a very, very bad phase, which we had never anticipated. Like after the first wave, we thought everything is over. And even our economy also started working very well. We got very good results. Even the performance everywhere was good. We were talking about 12%, 13% growth. Now suddenly we are hit by the second wave. So, sir, what are your views on this? How bad it is? What could be the effect of this? Because first, during the first wave, there were a lot of good measures which were taken by the government, RBI, everybody. You know, there were moratorium. There were moratorium on interest. There were so many government to just open the coffers. But this time, nothing like that. You know, sir, just a few small announcement of that 50,000 crore credit and 10,000 crore credit line for the small businesses. So what is your view, sir, that what do you think can happen now in this circumstance? Can we go back again in the old rate of the NPAs? And can the situation be beyond, capacity?
Yeah, it's a major concern. I think I would like to respond to this in two parts. The first one is, as we see it as a health crisis. See, as a health crisis, it has hit us in a manner in which none of us thought about it. And it has hit us so rapidly and within such a short time, and that the infection rate as well as mortality rate has been 3-4 folds more than what we have seen in the first wave. To that extent, it is a major setback. And I think the government machinery as well as the health infrastructure is trying to cope up with this kind of a setback that has come about. So as a health impact, I think it's a major impact. But how much of this will get translated or transferred to financial sector? We have seen that during the COVID wave one also, that there have been prolonged lockdowns, national lockdowns as well as localized lockdowns, which interrupted the supply chain, which also interrupted the jobs as well as income earning capacity of people. So today, as we sit and speak, the financial impact is seen to be maybe a fraction of what we saw, because there are no national lockdowns. There are still, the country is by and large functional, but for areas in which where it is majorly impacting the mobility. The rest of the country, the supply chains are more or less all right at this point in time. And we, if you look at the kind of GST collections that went through over the last 4-5 months, are an indication that the economic activity has revived. But the point that I would like to make is that the recovery is uneven, as all of us are seeing. And it is not going to be a broad-based recovery, as we know, as the governor also highlighted it yesterday. So we have got to take certain microprudential measures. It's not that, you know, you do a broad brush in terms of giving moratorium for all. Because the impact, as we saw last time also, even when the moratorium was given as blanket to everybody, we saw most banks, 5, 7, 9, 10% of the people only availed it. 90% of the people continued to service their loans. Large corporate did not make use of this at all. It is that MSME segment and slightly mid-sized corporates which were impacted. Large ones never availed any of this. Even if you look at the Commerce Committee recommendations and then 1500 crore banking exposure today, we have just two cases in the entire country which has got referred to that oversight committee, which means the large corporates are generally insulated. The individuals, more than 90% of them continue to service their installments. So the impact is probably minor. So I think the RBI is taking targeted measures at this point in time to protect the most vulnerable segment. I think that is what we should look at. While, of course, intuitively, we may want to believe, looking at the kind of infections and mortality that is taking place, that financial impact can be huge. But we are sort of having gone through the learning curves of the wave one. While, of course, it is not exact copy, it can be slightly different. But I think the financial impact is going to be localized in terms of most vulnerable segment. And as long as the government and the regulator are taking steps to ensure adequate liquidity in the system for the institutions to survive, I mean the financial institutions to survive, and on the other hand, address the needs of the most vulnerable segment, that is the marginalized, underprivileged, or the micro, small, and medium enterprises, I think we should be able to weather this storm. Is what is my sense on this at this point in time. But situation is evolving. We have not seen the end of it. Maybe over the period of next few couple of weeks, we will know as to how this curve is playing out. I'm fairly confident that the government and RBI are keeping their eyes and ears open. And if further measures are necessary, I don't think they will be found wanting in terms of announcing anything further that may be needed. But the mantra is, focus on where the help is needed rather than doing a broad brush. I think that is what is the approach. And we are of the opinion that that's the right approach for this moment. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Sir, we take some of the questions. I think Baldotaji is there, sir. You would like to say something, sir, or to speak something?
No, you can unmute yourself. The discussion that has gone, it was quite interesting. And already sufficient answers have been given and ideas have been given. Very happy to see Mr. Swaminathan here today. Very nice. Thank you, Mr. Ajmera, for the providing us this discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We have certain questions. Pallavi, you can also take some questions. Whether Mr. Amit Jain is there? Amit Jain has raised... Amit ji, are you there? You can unmute yourself. Pallavi, you can find Amit Jain. Axis Bank. Amit ji, unmute yourself. Okay, we have a... until he comes... we have a question that where's the main screen? That if out of the consortium some accounts are still not NPA, they are standard accounts. So Mr. Swaminathan, in that case, what is the status of taking it to National NARC?
So no, if I understood it correctly, that with some banks the account is still standard. Will it go to NARC? A portion of the asset is standard in somebody's books. Is that what you mean?
Yes, that's a question that is posted. That's right.
Yes, yes.
No, obviously, at this point, my answer would be that it may not, because these are for NPAs and aggregation is important. If some bank has kept it standard for some reason, I think that will be an excluded item.
Yes.
Okay. Pallavi, can you take others' questions?
There are not too many questions that have been posted in the chat box, but we can ask the participants to unmute themselves. And
okay, just give them the option.
Yes, I will.
Somebody has asked about this collection efficiency ratio, whether it has gone, but it is nothing to do with the bad bank. Mr. Swaminathan, whether it has got affected now, it is getting affected.
Collection efficiency, I don't have the current number at this point in time. So I'm sorry, but that's something which probably we can see offline, but at this point in time, I don't have the numbers.
Yeah, okay, time is at least one quarter we will see, then only we will be able to, particularly retail, we have to watch at least one quarter.
Yes.
Then only any commitments can be made.
Very right, sir. Very right, sir.
Yes.
Amit ji, aap hai kya idhar? आपने
वेरी मच देयर गुड इवनिंग सर
हां या प्लीज आस्क योर क्वेश्चन प्लीज अमित जी अमित जैन फ्रॉम एक्सिस बैंक या
सो माय क्वेश्चन इज लाइक इन अब्रॉड देयर आर लॉट ऑफ एलजीडी मॉडल्स व्हिच आर देयर टू डिटरमाइन द फेयर प्राइस ऑफ दीस एसेट्स सो अदर देन द दिस इज चैलेंज मेथड व्हिच इज अ टाइम कंज्यूमिंग लॉन्गेस्ट It takes lot of time. Is India geared up for a good LGD model, which can be used by the ARCs?
Mr. Swaminathan.
Okay. No, I thought maybe Pallavji would be better to answer that because the
you
question
want,
is on LGD models for ARCs.
Okay, Mr. Mohapatra.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, I think, Mr. Amit, this is not basically restricted in India. And whenever the ARCs are doing bilateral deal, so they are going on this LGD model. So Swiss challenge and LGD model are not complementary to each other. See, Swiss challenge is what? Swiss challenge is that the banks want to have a price discovery. So they get a binding offer from a ARC. That binding offer, whatever the ARC has computed, can be on LGD model, can be on enterprise valuation, can be on NPV value. So on whatever they have worked out, and the bank which is leading the consortium, or if it is a sole banking, that bank will see whether that particular price is fitting into their policy or not. If it fits into, then in order to maximize that price, they may go with this Swiss challenge. And when you say that a Swiss challenge is a long drawn process, I will beg to differ, because the moment there is a binding offer, then this is put on the auction, and only 21 days time is given to the ARCs to do the due diligence, because this is a regulatory requirement. And after 21 days, the auction date is there. And within two to three days of the auction, the money is into the account. So I don't think that there is much of a difference. The only difference is in foreign countries, especially developed countries, they have experts in doing the resolution, which as of now, as compared to that skill set, we do not have that level of skill set in India. That is the only difference. And that's the reason that those who are having a backing of Special Situation Fund or AIS, who have got a team of very good resolution professionals, they are able to do the resolution faster. They know that which type of assets are resolvable and which type of assets are not. So, I think till this expertise is gained over a period of time, these foreign investors and especially Special Situation Fund should be given more scope to invest in India.
Just to, I can, with your permission, I can just add on to what Pallavji said. See, number one, Amitji, this is a transfer that is taking place to NARC. This is not the final realization. Assuming that the NARC becomes the H1 bidder and then it gets transferred, you have 1585, and then any upside in realization is going to come to the SR holders once the AMC, as explained by Pallavji, AMC is able to warehouse this, do an O&M, the sector specialist can work on it, because the very, very fact as to why an AMC structure is being thought about is to bring the sector specialist so that they can get the better realization out of it. So the SR holders are going to have the upside. So the transfer amount is not the final realization amount. There is going to be, if there is a better warehousing and better realization happening 1 or 2 or 3 years from the date of transfer to NIRC, the SR holders are going to get benefited. The equity holders in the ARC are going to be benefited by way of whatever is the ARC money that is being made in the process, or the AMC money that is being made in the process. So it is the Swiss challenges at this point in time is for the transfer of the asset, as well as the NIRC is concerned. While for rest of the ARC, it is a sale. And then SR realizations takes a little different path. So that is what we will have to know at this point in time. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much. Yes, we can take up 1 or 2 questions more. Mr. Rathi also has a question, and Mr. Mangal also. So can you unmute yourself?
Yes, please. Mr. Rathi?
Yeah, thank you so much. I got 2 questions. This government guarantee, it's part of government's borrowing, whether it will be part of fiscal deficit, any idea? And my second question is, this NIRC resolution mechanism, whether it will be similar to other ARCs, or they are going to have some innovative resolution mechanism?
Yeah, if I can respond to that, see, when a sovereign guarantee is given, whatever is the accounting treatment, at least to the best of our knowledge, we are not privy to a different treatment being given to this. So it will be a sovereign guarantee. The accounting treatment will be very similar. There, at least we are not aware of any special provision being made for this. The second, that what you have to remember is, as we spoke in that hypothetical example that we took, even if assuming that 1 lakh crore of asset get transferred, the NARC is going to make an offer on the possible realizable value, of which 85% is going to be the SRs. So the guarantee requirement is again not going to be a big number as equivalent to that of NPA, because people get enamored by the kind of number on the NPA side. So it is not going to be that. Ultimately, the NARC is going to determine the realizable value, and they being H1 bidder, they are going to take it. If someone else is the H1 bidder, the NARC and government guarantee does not kick in at all. Some other ARC comes and then they prove to be the H1, they walk away, they pay from their resources. Government is not going to put out anything from their hands. If NARC becomes H1 bidder, 85% of that promised value is what is going to be the government guarantee, which will go generally as per the likely realizable value of that particular asset, which will vary from asset to asset. It can be 5%, 10%, 15%, 20%, 25%. But our overall experience is that the realizations have not been more than 20-25% on an average basis, if you take all sectors. So the guarantee requirement is not going to be very
good. Can I have,
Your second question on will there be special innovative ways? Yes, definitely. That is why this NARC and the AMC structure is being thought about. Sector specialists, domain experts, AMC will have all of them, and they will do the O&M to ensure that the asset is warehoused, restored, and then showcased, including running the VDRs. So there are going to be a lot of innovative strategies that will be followed by this particular structure. I'm sure that value maximization being the key word, they will adopt the innovative methods, and there are also people working in terms of understanding the international best practices, and I'm sure they will get incorporated as this structure comes into play. That's what I would
I want to respond to the first question of Mr. Rathi. Rathi sahab, regarding whether this sovereign guarantee will be a part of the fiscal deficit or not, as far as I know the accounting in the government, the guarantees which are given by the government or by the state government are not a part of fiscal deficit, but they form a part of fiscal responsibility budget management. So if suppose as per the FRBM, the central government or state government, they cannot cross this much percentage, so sovereign guarantee or the state government guarantee are a part of that, but they are not part of the fiscal deficit.
Thank you so much, sir.
If I get it closer, anyway, the it's breaking the sound.
I think we can just take up one last question from Mr. Ramdas. I do, because I'm not able to understand what his question is. It's on the chat form. Mr. Naidu, would you like to unmute yourself?
Okay. Mr. Naidu.
Says how it works in account, which is party with bank and party with an ARC. I'm not really sure what the question is.
Yeah. If the account is bad and it is partly with ARC and partly with the bank, how would it work? Like, ARC is also a party in that bad account.
So you are talking about that there is a consortium where some banks have sold the asset to ARC and
yes,
some banks are keeping the account with them, right?
Yes, sir.
No, then this is because the ARC will be just like any other bank in the consortium. And that is the major problem with the ARCs are facing today, because since they are not able to do the debt aggregation, so the resolution or restructuring, whatever they want to do, they are facing the problem. Because for doing any restructuring, they need the consent of all other financial creditors. So, if it can be, some of the banks can keep the NPA account with them, and other banks have sold the account to ARC, and debt aggregation has not taken place. So, that is the major issue which most probably the committee which is working on this comprehensive review of ARC will be looking into this. I presume that whatever is the structure in the IBC, that is, if 66% by value, they vote in favor of a plan, then the remaining will be basically treated as a dissenter. The same type of formula, most probably, they will bring in the ARC recognition. This is my presumption.
Yes, okay. Sir, I have one question with Mr. Swaminathan, which has also come from, with this NARC coming in, with this NARC coming in, Mr. Swaminathan, a lot of cases will be taken off from the IBC, NCLT, where now it is going to be offered to NARC. What is your idea on that, estimate on that? No, now you are mute. Sorry.
Yeah. You are right. Part of the account that are identified for transfer will be under IBC process. But a mere transfer of asset to NARC is not going to give rise for withdrawing from the IBC procedure. IBC procedure will continue to be alive. Now, NARC will have to take this forward and the IBC process will continue. In case if they are able to find a better resolution, a withdrawal mechanism is always available before a package is approved. So I think that is how it will go. Transfer to NARC will not result in an automatic withdrawal from the IBC process. That is my understanding.
Yes, okay. We all agree.
So
I think Mangal Morwal has been trying to ask a question. I keep
seeing his arm
raised for a long time. Maybe one question we can take from him.
Yes, in fact, I asked him, Mr. Morwal, Can you ask your question?
Good evening to panelists and participants. My question is on ASSAR. The bank's experience of the banks have been not very good while dealing in ASSAR. And of late, banks have stopped or started dealing in the cash only with the ARCs. So how this, although the guarantee, sovereign guarantee is there, how the mechanism will be different or the valuation of the SR will be taken care with the NARC? Because generally
I can respond to this. See, in the interest of time, I will very quickly respond. See, as far as the SR, these are government guaranteed, number one. These are going to be tradable, which means that any holder should be able to realize at least the face value or whatever is the market value of that security. Once you have a secondary market, obviously a price discovery takes place and the money can be realized to the equivalent of whatever is the market value. The third and most important is that even for a holder, there is an assurance of a shortfall guarantee. But what is that the government will guarantee? If SR holders, if ARC is able to realize the asset and pay them in full, then there is no question of government guarantee coming in. It is only question of to the extent of shortfall, the government will back up. So, and since we are thinking in terms of a NARC AMC structure where a better warehousing and better realization and nurturing back and showcasing the asset to including alternate investment funds, it is expected these SRs will give a better return as compared to our past experience. While of course our past experience has not been very great, but that is something I think in the presentation that we saw. But the current structure, it is expected that will give us a better realization backed by a government guarantee. But it's a valid concern at this point in time, going by the SR experience in the past. That's a precise reason I would imagine that the government is saying that I will give you a shortfall guarantee. In case if SRs at the period of say 3 years, 5 years or 7 years is not redeemed at all, the banks are required to write off, or it is only partly redeemed, the realization, to the extent of the difference, government guarantee can come in. So that is the support structure that is coming. So I think these SRs going to be to that extent better as compared to our SR experience of the past.
Thank you, sir. I hope you have answered questions of everyone, because a lot of questions came, which I had already covered in my discussion earlier also with you all. So with this, sir, I'm very, very thankful on behalf of Ascon Global, on behalf of my entire team, Pallavi and all of us have been working on it. We are thankful to you a lot, Mr. Swaminathan Janakiraman, for sparing your valuable time, sir. In today's time when you are so busy, taking out almost 2 hours out of your schedule is really, we appreciate, and we are very, very thankful to you, sir. Similarly, Mr. Pawar Pallav Mohapatra, sir. Of course, you have always been available whenever I had any kind of seminar or discussions and everything. But sir, thanks a lot to you also for sparing your time and giving a lot of insight into the whole subject. And of course, Mr. Gopala Krishna, he has been helping us a lot, even in to Pallavi also, in ACF, CS also. He has got great insight into the entire banking and financial matters. Sir, we appreciate your help and support, sir. And we are thankful to you for having come in this seminar and made it so wonderful, so successful. At one point of time, I think we had 225 to 330 people. All our elite people, the professionals, some of the industrialists, businessmen, bankers. And I hope they all must have got benefited with this discussion. We are thankful to them, to all the participants, especially Baldoda ji. I just sent him the message and he was there almost full time. So thank you everyone. Thank you Ascon team and all our guests. Thanks a lot. And we will have a similar kind of discussions and webinars on the banking and financial matters. And on this, especially on this, we may have after 2 or 3 months with the same panel, the discussion, to have the final clarity on the whole thing. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Ajmera.
Thank you, Ajmera ji.
Thank you very much.
Thanks to the co-panelists and also all the participants. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Take care. Take care. Stay safe.
Thank you.